Okay, we're on. All right, everybody. Welcome once again to another masterclass. And this one is extra special because this is the last one. This is masterclass number 10. So we have two very special guests with us. They are students from the Modern Languages Program. Up on the right, where I can see, we have Nicole Hernandez Garcia, and right below me, where the cameras are, I have Nicolas Duarte Ramirez. Welcome, Nicole, and welcome, Nicolas. How are you guys?
Hello. I'm very good, and you?
I'm doing great. Is this your first time in a masterclass, Nicolas?
Yeah, this is my first time, actually.
Okay, and how do you feel?
I feel a little bit anxious, a little bit, let me say nervous, but not nervous at all. Like more, I don't know, expectant what this is going to be. But okay. I'm super good.
Okay. Welcome, Nicole. How are you?
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm pretty good today. And how are you?
I'm doing great. How do you feel for today's masterclass?
Well, I'm excited too, and I hope to have a great time and to share many interesting topics today with all of you.
Okay, that is good. So for those of you who will be watching this on YouTube at a later date, welcome also. We have some interesting things we want to share with you guys today. We're going to get going, and just keep in mind that if you're watching this at a later date, you can ask questions, but I guess you can ask them directly to us, to our emails, and we will happily answer those questions for you. So we begin with our traditional hello, everybody. We hope you're all doing well. What do we have for us today? Well, first, welcome to Masterclass number 10, and we have two things we're going to share with you guys. One is, are we bilingual? And the other one is translation and interpretation. So the three of us, we're going to do this all together. Are we bilingual? But the second part, translation and interpretation, will be done by our two guests, because I think they have more, let's say they have more experience with this. I've been a translator and an interpreter, but probably a few years back. So I haven't done any of those in a while. So you guys, both of you, Nicolas and Nicole, who are, you know, you guys are up to date on all these things. You guys can lead that part. But yeah, we have some very good information. So let's continue on right here. One second. Whoops. Okay. So first thing we'll work on is called Are We Bilingual? And number two is translation and interpretation. So the first question we see right here on the screen is, are we bilingual? Sometimes that is a difficult question to answer. Sometimes it may be easy, but it depends on the point of view that we have of what is bilingualism, what it means to be bilingual. So I want to start by asking both of you, what is your opinion on this? Do you consider that you are bilingual, Nicole and Nicolas?
Well, I would say that I'm not sure. I would say that yes. I think yes. But I would like to know more about this interesting topic.
Okay. What about you, Nicolas?
Okay, at this point, I really don't know. I'm not sure. I can think that probably I am, but probably I am not. Because, well, I can speak English, I can understand, but not at all. You know, like, I need to learn a lot to be our bilingual. That is what I think in this moment.
Okay, very good. I want to take a couple seconds here and say hello to a very, very special friend, person that I've known for a very long time. She is very sweet, and she is a great professor as well. Her name is Marta Roman. Hello, Marta. How are you?
Hi. How are you? I almost couldn't get in. I don't know. I lost the
oh really
the link. Yeah, I was trying like
okay.
10 minutes ago. Thank you
oh,
for
okay.
your welcoming message.
Okay, but yeah, I'm really happy to see you here. I did not expect that you would be here, so it really
well, it
puts a smile
attention.
On my face. Okay, that's good.
Thank
that's
you.
Good. Welcome, and if you, I would really like you to be part of the conversation as well. So we have these two topics of bilingualism and of translation and interpretation. So can I ask you that question as well, Martika? Do you consider that we are bilingual, or you personally, do you feel you are bilingual?
I think I am because I understand mostly what people say in English.
Okay.
However, sometimes there are things that I do not know, of course,
oh, okay.
because I don't know everything. That's what I would say.
All right. And do you think
in terms of translating and interpreting, I think that you need to have like special skills
okay
in order to do a good translation or a good interpretation.
Okay, very good. All right, thank you for your input on that. So before we know what you know what it really means to be bilingual, I want to ask you guys this following question. We're going to watch a short video, and we usually have the ideas that those of us who speak Spanish, you know, when we think about English, we ask ourselves, are we really bilingual? But these people are from North America, and we're going to listen to them speaking Spanish. So we'll listen to them first, and then we will answer that question. Do we think they are bilingual? So listen very carefully. Here we go.
Las profesoras nos han dicho, bueno, hay una oportunidad a ir a España a estudiar ahí. Entonces yo hacía un intercambio y vivía con una familia en el centro de España, cerca de Toledo. Y me encantó y fue como una temporada en mi vida muy importante. Y me encanta España, la cultura latina.
Hola, ¿cómo estás? Yo soy Jack Black. Kung Fu Panda es una película de comedia para toda la familia, con mucho corazón, mucha acción y sobre todo muchas risas, y creo que les va a encantar a todos. ¿Está bien? Mira, mi español es perfecto. Mira mi cara. Mi español es muy bonita, ¿no? Y mi acento es perfecto. Muchas gracias. Adiós.
Tu hija habla mejor español que tú y eso te frustró.
Sí,
es muy difícil. Mi hija tiene 14 años y ya es un poquito mejor que yo.
Qué bien.
Pero siempre supe que tuve acento mejor porque aprendí español en México cuando tuve 13 años. Vive allá. Y entonces supe que no tengo un perfecto vocabulario o los verbos, pero tengo acento. Y entonces estuve trabajando con Ana de Armas.
Correcto.
Y pregúntala, escucha a mi hija y escucha mi acento y dime cuál es mejor. Mi hija dice,
muy, muy importante, you know, creo que en los Estados Unidos la gente habla un idioma, pero todas las países del mundo la gente habla dos o tres idiomas. So.
Yeah, you know, I mean,
All right, so what do you guys think? We have four famous people, Gwyneth Paltrow, we have Jack Black, Will Smith, and the other guy, I lost his name for some unknown reason. You think, can we consider them bilingual?
Well, I think they are. they have committed some basic mistakes, but I think they can communicate what they want to say.
Okay. What do you think, Nicolas?
I don't know. It's a really good question. Probably they are, because, well, they, as Nicole said, they transmit an information, they transmit a message, but, well, they still commit a lot of mistakes about, you know, pronunciation and a lot of different things. So I don't know. It's a really good question.
Okay. Marta, what do you think? You think we can consider them bilingual?
I would say so. Yeah. They get their message through. So I think that makes them bilingual. The thing that there is a different level of proficiency, I would say.
Okay. All right. That is true.
Yeah. But I would say they made themselves understood. So I think they are bilingual.
Okay. So you touched upon a very important word, Martika, and that is proficiency. So before we can determine who is bilingual, we need to know what bilingualism is and what it means to be bilingual. So we have a few bilingualism definitions. And the first one is brought to us by Encyclopedia Britannica. And they say it's the ability to speak two languages. Now, they always update their definitions, and this one was updated this year, 2023. So the second one we have is from a very famous, in our field, a very famous dictionary, which is dictionary. I don't speak French, so Nicole, can you pronounce that for us?
Okay, that would be something like Dictionnaire des Français Larousse.
Okay, very good. Very good. Very good accent. And they say it's a situation of a person who speaks two different languages. So the first one from Encyclopedia and this one from the LaRouche, they seem to be very similar because they both talk about speaking. Now, those are two very famous publications that you can find. Now we get into two authors. And the first one is Bloomfield. And Bloomfield says the native-like control of two languages. When we look at the word native, I mean, we're talking about C1, C2 level. So they're taking it up a notch and they're considering that the only way we can consider people to be bilingual is if they have the native-like control of both languages. We can differ and we can say probably not, because we just saw a video with four famous people who probably are not C1, C2 level, but we can, you know, say they are bilingual, because as you guys said before, they matched their proficiency levels and they were able to transmit their messages very clearly. But then as Martika said before, we have to consider that not all of them are at the same proficiency levels. However, their messages were clear and comprehensible. So, you know, we can kind of say Bloomfield in this case, we're not gonna say he's incorrect because he is an expert or was an expert on this, but yeah, we need to consider that he is considering the native-like control of two languages. And finally, we have this person, his name is MacArthur, and he says it's the capacity to make alternate and sometimes mixed use of two languages. So we can consider the capacity to make alternate is probably also if we think about code switching or language switch. And that's when we say part of what we think in Spanish and the other part in the second language, or in our case, in the foreign language. So these are the four bilingualism definitions. However, let's consider that there are many, many, many more. But because of time constraints, we cannot look at all of them or many of them. If you guys have any questions about these, you can ask me now, or if you want to make any comments about any of these definitions, please feel free to do so. Anything you want to say about that, Nicolas or Nicole or Martika, anything you guys want to say?
Well, I'm in agreement with what you said about the native control, because I think it's a little bit difficult to get that native like way of talk, because we are not like immersed in the culture, but
okay.
It's not impossible, but it's a little bit difficult.
Okay, that is true. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, we cannot consider, you know, our bilinguals here in Colombia to be, or to have that native-like control, because it's true, we're not immersed in a place where English is our second language. It is still a foreign language. And for the majority of people, we can say that, you know, it will always be a foreign language. Okay, anything you want to add to that, Nicolas or Martica?
No, I think I'm done like that.
Okay, all right. So, yes.
Well, I like MacArthur's definition.
Yeah.
Because okay. It's not taken into account like the level of proficiency, but just saying a person who can like interact in both languages and make changes. It may be considered bilingual.
Oh, okay, that is true. That is very true. Yeah. So in this case, the word make alternate, yes, alternate use, we can, I guess we can not really translate, but we can interpret that in whichever way we want, because I think that word is open to what we may think about it. And it's not really talking about having a native-like control, as Bloomfield says. But yeah, you're right on the money with that one, Martica. Yeah, what MacArthur says. All right, so we've seen some bilingualism definitions. Let's look at types of bilinguals or bilingualism. The first one we all know, and you know, I'm not gonna ask you guys what you think about this, but this one's pretty easy. This one says a bilingual is a person who is proficient, and we gotta consider proficient being a very important word in the study of bilingualism, in two languages or speaks two languages fluently. What I would like to say in terms of fluently is that many students, probably at the Modern Languages program, at the beginning think that fluency is how fast you speak, but no. To be fluent is to be a natural speaker of the language. So I wanted to make that point. But as it says right here, it's a person who is proficient in two languages or speaks two languages fluently. The four people from Hollywood we saw a while ago, we can say that their proficiency levels are different. I think that the best ones were the first one, Gwyneth Paltrow, and the third one, which was Ben Affleck. They had more proficient or a better proficiency level than the other two. However, all four, I think, were fluent when they were speaking. Therefore, we can consider them bilingual. Let me ask you guys, all three of you, considering what bilingual is and considering that definition we have there, can we attest to saying that we are bilingual? According to that definition? Nicolas, what do you think?
I'm sorry, according to this one that appears in the screen.
Yeah. Do you consider yourself to be bilingual?
I think no, because well,
nope.
This, because I think it depends on the proficiency, as you said, and at this moment, well, I have like a proficiency level that is going to be tested, but I don't know right now, and I don't know if I can transmit or I am fluent at all. Like sometimes, as you said, I can say I thought that be fluent is like to like the capacity to speak fast, or well, okay. to know, you know, to communicate something in a good way without having like a lot of troubles. But right now, I don't know, because I have to think what I am going to say, and I have to manage like a lot of vocabulary, and I think that is also regarding like the fluency, like to have enough vocabulary to transmit your ideas.
Okay, all right. What do you think, Nicole?
Well, I was thinking about the word fluently also, and it's very interesting what you have said about the way to speak like naturally and all these things. So taking into consideration this definition, I can say that I could be bilingual. Yes, I know that I have to improve so many things. I have a lot of things to learn, but I think I can like be able to express my ideas and to express what I want to say.
Okay, very good. What about you, Martika? What do you think about this this statement right here in terms of
proficiency? Well, according to that, I would say yes, I am bilingual. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, that's definition that says there. A person who is proficient in two languages or speaks two languages fluently.
Yes.
Even though here they are only talking about like the oral component of the language, is that, am I right?
Yes, yes, and that's good that you say that, because we're gonna see some other types of bilinguals, and then we will say, okay, we didn't know about this, so we thought it was just one thing, which is bilingual, which is on the side of speaking or producing oral language. But yeah, you are correct in saying that. But for the most part, I believe that the four of us are bilingual. I think we do meet the necessities of being able to transmit in both languages, and that we are proficient and that we are fluent. So yes, I think we can all four check that box. Okay, but let's look at the other types. There are more types as well. Okay, do you guys know what a bimodal bilingual is? Anybody have an idea? Nicolas, do you have an idea of what bimodal bilingual is? Any idea, Nicolas?
No.
No? Okay. Martika, do you have an idea of what a bimodal bilingual is?
First time in my life that I see that word. Bimodal.
Okay. All right. Nicole, I think you might have an idea of what a bimodal bilingual is, right?
Well, if I'm not wrong, I think it's related to the sign language. So it's like a person who is able to speak and to understand the sign language and to transfer that information into spoken language.
Okay, so when we talk about types of bilinguals and bilingualism, we need to know all the spectrums. And this is probably one that, you know, we don't comply with. But as Nicole said, yes, it is a person who can code blend between a spoken and a sign language. The example given right here would be spoken English and English sign language. So yeah, this is a difficult one, because I kind of believe that us four, we do not, I'm not gonna say speak, but know an English sign language, or any sign language for that matter. I've seen people do some, you know, gestures with their hands, and you know, some of them I know what they might be, but I am not proficient enough to say that I understand it. No. Martika, do you know sign language?
No, unfortunately not.
Oh, okay. All right, but basically that is a bimodal bilingual, but we have to have it here because, you know, we need to show all the different types of bilinguals. Now, we're only going to see five, but there are many, many more. There are many, many more. So let's continue with the next one. That is a bimodal bilingual. I think I have known two people who are bimodal bilingual. Martika, did you ever meet a student who is a professor now, but he's in the United States, Chilito. Do you remember him?
No, no.
Juan David Chilito, no?
No, no.
Okay, well, he studied at the Modern Languages Program. He graduated and he became a professor there for a while. And he was, and he still is, bimodal bilingual. Here in Colombia, he's probably the only one I met. And he knew both. In terms of a sign language, he knew English and he knew Spanish. And he was like the interpreter or the translator for the community of people who use the sign language. And one time we had this activity at the auditorium at the university, and he was the one translating for everybody. That's when I learned that when people who use sign language, they want to clap, they don't clap, they do this. That is the sign for clapping. That's when I learned that. And so, you know, it was interesting to see. But yeah, so bimodal bilinguals do exist, and that is a type of bilingualism. The next one we have is a simultaneous. Yes, tell me.
I'm asking, so that Juan David also is also a translator for Spanish and Spanish, yes, sign language.
Exactly.
In English and English sign language.
Is, yeah,
that
exactly,
what you mean?
Wow. Yeah, that's what, yeah.
I, yeah, have only Spanish for who speaks Spanish, of course, and
yeah,
and who know sign language.
Okay, interesting. I find that so interesting. People who are able to communicate with the signs, and you know, before that, I had no idea that we would consider, or we should, and we need to consider them bilingual people. And you know, the name that they carry for bilingual is bimodal bilinguals. Yeah, very interesting. All right, the next one, number three, we have right here is simultaneous bilingual. Let me ask Nicole, do you have an idea what a simultaneous bilingual is, Nicole?
Simultaneous, yeah, well, I don't remember if it is the one related to the child, to a childhood, and that we grow up when with both languages at the same time.
Okay.
All right.
Nicolas, do you have any idea of what a simultaneous bilingual is?
No.
Okay. And an Martha, had you ever seen this type of bilingual, simultaneous?
Well, I'm trying to guess what it is. I would say, okay, somebody who can switch and think, probably think in both languages, that you can, okay, do it at the same time. Something like,
okay,
that.
Okay, because of the word simultaneous, right?
Yeah, that's what, okay, I'm trying to get.
Okay, well, what you said is not far off, because that might be the product, yes, of what this person is, a simultaneous bilingual. It's a form of bilingualism that takes place when a child is exposed to two languages at or before birth. So when a child is born and has parents, one that speaks one language and one that is a different language, that is a form of simultaneous bilingual. I know a few people who are, in this case, simultaneous bilinguals. And they were exposed to both languages before birth and at birth. So did you have an idea about that one, Martha?
I'm trying to think. I remember when I was a college student, okay, I remember reading a book about that, about bilingualism. Yeah. And I think this happens in the environment. Let's say somebody, a couple, from the United States, or maybe the father speaks English and the mother speaks Spanish, and they have a baby here in Colombia, let's say. So that person, that baby could be part of it, because it's here learning or acquiring Spanish and at the same time communicating with the father, in this case, in English. And I think it happens in the States. But I remember that I tried to do that when I got pregnant.
Oh, okay.
Well, I exposed my baby to the language, but not not my English, but recordings, videos, lots of things.
All right.
But when I try to speak, and I think it's because of my accent, she refused. So she rejected that.
Oh,
so
really?
I was trying to, but when she was able to speak, she said, "Don't talk to me like that. I don't like it."
Wow.
That's what she said. So I stopped doing that. And I think it's because she was not in the environment. And if I had been maybe a native speaker, probably it would have worked out. That's what I feel.
But see, you're not off on that also, because that happened with me and my children when they got approximately to the age of 8 or 9, they didn't want to speak English anymore because their environment at school was mostly Spanish. But the good thing about that is they haven't forgotten English. You know, if I talk to them, I know they will answer me. So yeah, to a certain extent they were, and they still are, simultaneous bilinguals, because they did learn it at birth, because I was the one always talking to them in English. Therefore, they did learn English and they still know it. But I guess because our context is mostly Spanish and their friends are not bilingual. So, you know, they're gonna resort to using more Spanish than they are English. However, I know they speak English because I have heard them talking to other people in English. So yeah, that is a simultaneous bilingual. Nicole, you know anybody who's a simultaneous bilingual?
Yeah, I know someone. I knew this person in the university, but well, I think if I had had this opportunity, that would be like something very important for me. I don't know why your children don't want to hear you speaking in English, but well, that's like the personal thoughts and ideas of each one.
Yeah, and they're affected by the community, and the community is all Spanish. So that's why they're pretty reluctant to speak English, and I guess they would feel like, you know, if I speak English, everybody's going to look at me. And as they were growing up and I would talk to them in English, if we were in a public place like a mall, you know, people would look and they would feel that people were looking at them. So they would feel uncomfortable. But and that's probably why they stopped. But I know they still speak because, I can say anything to them in English and they'll know what I'm saying. And when they play video games with people from other countries, especially from the United States, you know, they talk in English as if they knew it perfectly. Some small issues with pronunciation, but the rest they still do. And so I'll tell them, "I heard you speaking English." And they said, "Yeah, because, you know, the people we play with are from other countries." But once it's here, it will stay. It's just a matter of practice. All right, so that is a simultaneous bilingual. Let's go to the next one. And the next one is a sequential bilingual. You ever heard about that one, Martica? Sequential bilingual?
No.
Nope. New? That one's new to you.
Didn't hear that.
That's new. That's new for you, right? Sequential?
Yeah. I'm okay. Trying to guess, but no. Okay. I am not going to check the rules.
All right. Nicolas, you want to take a risk at saying what a sequential bilingual is?
No.
No. All right. Nicole?
Well, I think this one has to do with like learning a language, let's say our mother language.
Yeah.
In this case, for example, Spanish. And then after a long period of time, or well, after some years, we learn the second language. For example, in my case, is English. Okay. And then French.
All right. Basically, that is it. So to be a sequential bilingual, that is a form of bilingualism that takes place later in life. The person learns a second or foreign language, in our case, some years after. And, you know, that's what happens. If we talk about kids who, you know, they're born here, obviously they speak L1 is Spanish. And later on, when they're, I don't know, 7, 8, 10 years old, their parents decide to enroll them in an English course, you know, wherever it may be at, that would be considered, that person would be considered as a sequential bilingual. Yeah. And I think that is the case for all of us. I think we can all check that box. We are sequential bilinguals. I learned Spanish, and when I was 4 years old, I was taken to the United States and I learned English. So it's like 4 years after I was born, that makes me a sequential bilingual. Okay, any questions about sequential bilinguals? Yes. No questions?
Yeah. It doesn't make distinction of acquiring it or learning it. Because I would say I am a sequential bilingual because I learned it when I went to college. But you are also a sequential bilingual, but
I acquired
you. Yeah.
Yes, I did acquire it. But yeah, this definition comes from MacArthur as well. And I kind of paraphrased it, but I left the word learn. He does not talk about acquire. He just left it at learn. But, you know, I guess we can make the distinction. Yeah, there are sequential bilinguals who learn it and sequential bilinguals who acquire it. And those who acquire it are the ones that did not study it, but picked it up because they were in the place where that language is L1. Yeah, but that's a good point, Martika. Yeah, he doesn't make the distinction between learning and acquiring it. But you know, we can look at it, analyze it, and say, yeah, there are sequential bilinguals who learn and sequential bilinguals who actually acquired the language. Okay, any other questions? So up to now, I think we can check two boxes. Number one, which is a bilingual, yes? And that is a person who is proficient and a person who is who has that level to be able to speak as natural as possible, fluency, or is fluent. We can check that box and we can check this box, sequential bilingual. And finally, we have this one, which is biliterate. Have you heard about this one, Marta?
But I'm trying to guess. That's
okay.
So you said literate, it would mean that you speak, you write, and you read.
Is that it? That's exactly it.
Both languages.
Yeah, so literate, that you're able to read and write, and biliterate is that you are able to read and write in two languages. So that is a person who is able to read and write in two languages. And are we biliterate? Not only bilingual, but are we biliterate?
I guess so. We all are.
Yeah. Nicole and Nicolas, you guys consider you guys are biliterate?
Well, for me, the written part is the most difficult one. Not like in short text, but for example, when I have to say an essay, when I have to do an essay and something like too long, I have trouble with the time. Okay, I need like so much time to organize because I try to think about a lot of things in the same moment. So I think that one, that would be like my point in which I don't feel like very comfortable. But in reading, I'm doing pretty good.
And when you write, do you think about, do you think in English or do you think in French also or in Spanish?
Well, I try to do it in English, but sometimes it's a little bit more easy to do it in Spanish. Well, it depends on the topic.
All right. Okay, good. And Nicolas, can you check that one and say, I am biliterate?
I can say that, yes. Well, with some trouble sometimes, but I can say that, yes. As Nicole said, sometimes I have some difficulties like writing essays, or, you know, like long text, but at the end I can do my best.
Okay. Yeah, so you can check that one. You are biliterate. I guess if you are an avid reader and writer in three languages, you would be triliterate. Yes?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, triliterate. And I think we can attest that. What about Nicolas? Are you a good writer in French?
In French, not at all, but I can like do my best. I okay. can express my ideas. I can say probably I am triliterate.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, sure. If you're able to produce language in written form and read it as well, yeah. If you can do all three, you can consider yourself triliterate. Marta, how's your French?
Oh my God. No. I lost it. Yeah, I was wondering about that. Yes, I lost it. No, not anymore. Okay. I think I right, can yeah. catch up again, probably.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, I completely forgot it. Believe me.
Okay. Yeah, that's the same thing with me. I can understand some things and I can say some things, but no, I'm not proficient enough to say that I know French. So I am biliterate. I am not triliterate. Okay. Any questions about biliteracy? You guys have any questions about biliteracy? No. Nope.
I didn't.
Okay. All right. So those are the five types that we are presenting today. And as I said before, there are many, many more. But you know, difficult to put them all. This next part, we're gonna go a little bit faster because we still have another section to talk about. But as we go through it, if you guys have any questions, please let me know. And they deal with the types of bilinguals and bilingualism. This is the part that I call the expansion. And if we look at the word expansion, is to expand. And we think about expanding bilingualism. And here are some more ideas. Multilingual or multilingualism, as we know, is using or promoting the use of multiple languages, either by an individual speaker or a community of speakers. We can say that at the University of Quindio, at our program, you know, we do promote multilingualism because we have a few people who know Portuguese. We have some people that know Italian. I know one professor who knows a lot of German. He's very proficient in German. You never see him because he's in the evening classes, but I think you know him, Martica, Sebastian. You know Sebastian?
No.
Oh, okay. I
don't know him.
Okay, if I'm not mistaken, I think he worked at the Colombo, but yeah, he's really good at German.
Sebastian.
Oh, I'm trying to remember his last name. I'll probably remember in a while and I'll tell you, Sebastian. I almost remember.
Sebastian, the one who was like the international relations officer at Universidad Gran Colombia.
Oh, no, not him. That's a different one. Yeah,
Sebastian Valenque, remember now.
Yeah. That's the other one. Yeah, that's the other one. Okay. No, I almost said his name. And I know him well and I forgot his last name. It's just that I don't see them that often. So that is multilingualism. It's the idea of promoting the use of multiple languages. We can probably see this in San Andres. Yeah, San Andres, they promote the use of multiple languages. Okay, let's continue. If you want to say something about multilingual or multilingualism, feel free to. Nope. All right, so the next one in what I call the expansion is trilingual, and obviously that's a person who is proficient in three languages. Nicole, I would consider you to be a trilingual person. And I don't know about Nicolas, because I haven't heard you speak French, so I don't know if I can call you a trilingual. But the other day we were talking and I said that I can consider myself trilingual because I think music, well, I don't think, I know music is a language. Music is an international language. I can read music and I can write music. Therefore, I would consider myself proficient in three languages, even though music is not verbally, unless you are a singer, transmitted to other people. It's by virtue of instruments and in many cases also by virtue of singing. So I don't sing, by the way. If I sing, it'll probably rain harder. So I'm not, I know how to sing, but it sounds ugly. Yeah. I can sing, but it sounds ugly. Can you sing, Martika? Okay, I think we might have lost her. Okay, do you guys sing, Nicolas or Nicole?
Sometimes I try to do it, but just for myself. I don't need to be heard.
Okay, but, yeah, but you like it. Do you like to do it?
Yeah, I really like to do it.
I enjoy it a lot.
And do you guys have, you know, technique? Are you proficient with technique?
No.
Nope.
No, I have never studied something like related to how to sing or to music. No.
Music, no, never, me neither.
Okay. Do you guys know that next Wednesday, the 1st of November, is the song contest?
Uh-huh.
I have heard something, but
The bilingual song.
The bilingual song contest. I think that's what it's called. I don't even know. And they invited me to be a judge. So I'm going to be a judge in that. And but because of my background in music, I can play guitar, the drums and piano. And before I used to play the trumpet and the saxophone, but I haven't touched a trumpet and saxophone in years. So I know I lost the practice, but I can still play piano, drums and guitar. So I consider myself trilingual if I consider that music is a language, because music transmits feelings, ideas, and so on and so forth. So yeah, I would say that as well. Okay. Oh, okay. Martika just wrote on the chat, I'm having
problems.
Yeah, cannot hear very well. Okay, you guys can hear me well, right? No problem.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Maybe it's her internet connection, which is bad. All right. Let's go on with the next one. So we have bilingual, we have trilingual, and obviously we have polyglot. Yeah, and the polyglot is a person who is proficient in more than three languages. More than three, yes? Up to three are trilingual. After that, polyglot. And then we have the biggest one of all, and that is the hyper polyglot. And that is a person who is proficient in more than 8 to 10 languages. We were having a discussion and I was telling the people who were listening to me that I met one person, well, I've known two people who are polyglots, hyper polyglots. And yeah, it's incredible to watch and listen and have them communicate, you know, as hyper polyglots, but they do exist. Nicolas, do you know any hyper polyglots?
No, never.
No?
I didn't know like the a difference between a polyglot and a hyper polyglot. I know if you know more than three languages, you're polyglot, no matter the quantity.
Now they have it as a hyper polyglot. Nicole,
that is something so incredible for me. Some day I remember I watched a video from, it was a little kid, it was a baby. And she speaks a lot of languages and she did it really well. And I was like, oh my God, I wanted to be here.
It's probably the same video that I saw. And if you look on YouTube, you put hyper polyglots, you will see a lot of them. There are many of them. Nicole, you know any hyper polyglots?
No, nope. I don't really know any. Oh. And I have never seen like videos related to that, but that's amazing. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, if you have the chance, look on YouTube, put in hyperpolyglots and you get a lot of videos.
Yeah, I will do it.
Yeah. All right. So we're going to go even faster through this one. This is called balanced versus dominant bilinguals. When we talk about a balanced bilingual, that is basically a person who is whose proficiency in both languages, L1 and L2, is almost equal. It's equivalent. You will never find somebody who has the exact equivalency between both languages, partially because we cannot measure how many words the person can use in terms of vocabulary in each language. We cannot measure how many sounds they are able to produce in each language. So it's very difficult. We can never say that they are equally balanced, but they are close to being equal. So a balanced bilingual is that person who is proficient in both L1 and L2, and they're almost identical in terms of levels. Then we have about balanced bilinguals is that their language skills are very close to being equal in each language, but as I said before, difficult to determine. What are some characteristics of balanced bilinguals? Well, we have that they are proficient and fluent in both languages. They have command of vocabulary, command of grammar, and command of pronunciation in both languages. Remember, almost balanced, but not quite balanced to determine that they are. Number three, they are able to code switch very easily. And if we think about what code switching is, you guys probably know what it is when I say a part in English and a part in Spanish. Are you guys good at code switching?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. Can you code switch between English, Spanish, and French?
Yes, I think we can do it.
I think yes. Sometimes is a little bit hard because you start to confuse like the pronunciation between the languages, but it is possible.
Okay. Because if I were to do it, I would get out of it easy. And I would say something like, Je m'appelle John, soy de Armenia, and I work at the University of Quindio. I'm not going to say anymore, just those three, okay? You guys can probably do
it. At that point, it's easy.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, so that's number three, code switching ability. Number four is cultural awareness. People who are balanced bilinguals, they have a very good idea of what the culture is in both languages. They know about it. They know what some nuances in the language, in the behaviors and the ways of thinking of both cultures. So they are culturally aware of both languages. And the last one is that through all of this, they become effective communicators. Their communication level is so effective that people who know either of the two languages and listen to them, they will say, yeah, this is perfect in both of them. So do you guys consider that you have these five characteristics for code switching? For balanced bilinguals?
Yes, I think I have this, like these characteristics.
Yeah, me too.
Okay, yeah, we do. Yeah, we should be honest and say, yes, we do. And then contrary to that, we have the dominant bilingual. And the dominant bilingual is a person with more proficiency in one of his or her languages and uses it more than the other. Now, here's some characteristics of the dominant bilingual. They have a strong preference for one of the languages. In other words, they are proficient and fluent in that one language. They also favor one for daily conversation, but the other one, they tend to put it aside. Number three, they prefer to express and listen or, enjoy entertainment only in one of the languages. Number four, they may have acquired or learned one of the languages at an early age. Of course, in our case, we learned Spanish first and then the other one. But, you know, we have that tendency because we study to be more balanced than dominant. And finally, these people who are dominant bilinguals exhibit more cultural acceptance in one of the languages than more than the other one. So these are five characteristics of dominant bilinguals. Okay, on a side note, for the people who are dominant, you know, I don't want them to feel like I am speaking bad about them or, you know, pointing a finger at them. But we all should take this into account. The aforementioned characteristics of both balanced and dominant bilinguals are simply generalizations. It's not everybody. So the characteristics can vary from person to person. And we also have different characteristics because how we use the language, how we behave in either of the languages and think in either of the languages, we are completely different. We are not the same. So we do carry different characteristics from, you know, all three or all four of us, because we think different, we use the languages completely different. And finally, bilingual people can exhibit a combination of traits from both languages. So yeah, in some ways we can be dominant instead of balanced because certain characteristics, and in others we are very balanced because we try to even out everything, whether it's through speaking, listening, reading, or writing, or something about the culture that we enjoy from both cultures. All right, that's the note. Bilingual education, what is bilingual education? It's teaching academic content in two languages. And you have to consider this, in a native and secondary or foreign language. So when we think about bilingual education, everything should be taught in both languages, the content. So if you're going to teach math at a school, math should be taught in both English and Spanish, and not more one than the other. They also have varying the amounts of each language, and it should be balanced when we think about bilingual education. There should not be more teaching in English than in Spanish or vice versa. Okay, what is the aim of bilingual education? Is it to be bilingual or biliterate? Or is it to be proficient in speaking, listening, or in reading and writing? Well, the idea is to have all of them. If you want to be a full bilingual, that's another form of bilingualism. Want to be a full bilingual, you have to be not only bilingual, but also biliterate. And if we think about biliterism, we need to read and write as well in both languages, and bilingual to speak and listen equally in both languages. However, today's trend is called the dual language program education. And here's what it is. Students are immersed in both languages simultaneously, the native language and the partner language. So they are immersed, and if they're taught how to let's say they teach them social studies, they will be exposed to both equally. And notice they don't call it a foreign or a second language. They call it a partner language, which is a term that we can consider to be friendly, yes, for the bilingual person in a dual language program. All right, this is a video. We're not gonna watch it because it's pretty long, but it talks about dual language programs in a two-way, not from one to the other, but both. They try to level the amount of language that is used in their education, considering that whatever is done in English will be done in Spanish as well, and vice versa. So who can benefit from bilingual education? Any learner? Yes, provided that the instruction and setting or the context are optimum and meets the needs of the student or students. And in conclusion, bilingual instruction is conceivably beneficial for any learner at any educational level, yes. And also, bilingual instruction is conceivably beneficial for any learner at any age, yes. Anybody at any age, provided that they want to can learn any language. So, are you bilingual? After seeing all of this, are you bilingual, Nicolas?
Yes, yeah. I think I am.
Definitely. Okay. All right, yes, we are. Remember, we can check the box on some of the bilingual types. So, yes, we are. Okay, that's for bilingualism. Whoops. Let's go to translation. And I want to let the experts talk about translation, because now you guys are more experts than I am, let's say, in terms of defining, in terms of speaking about it. But I can translate. But if I have to put names to things, you guys are the experts.
Okay, thank you. Okay, well, for this part, we want to start by asking you what is translation. So before to give you a definition, you can scan the QR code or simply go through this link, and in one or two words give an opinion about what is translation.
Okay, and for those of you who are watching this at a later date, you can do it and you will get something like this. I mean, you'll see it backwards there, but that's what you get, the idea. So I'm going to put my word in there. Yes?
I'm going to write something too.
And I'm going to see if I can see your answers.
Oh, I lost the word. Oh, I got it. Okay, I submitted mine. I don't know, Nicolas, if you can see it.
I'm trying to do that.
Okay.
I have sent my answers too.
Yeah, I can see now. Give meaning, the act of interpreting, written text, cultural awareness. Yeah.
Okay, I just wrote the act of interpreting, and I guess the rest is from Nicole.
Yeah, I have four responses.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, so we're going to start like talking a little bit about what you said in the answers, okay? So for example, taking into consideration the one that the professor writes is the act of interpreting. Yes. We can take it like in this time, in that way, like interpretation, but later on we're going to see if translation and interpretation are the same thing, okay? So we can see the next slide, please. And here we have a basic definition according to Foster, and it says, translation is an act through which the content of a text, or like the message of a text, is transferred from one language to another, okay? It means that we are going like to transmit one written message from one language, let's say Spanish, into another language. In this case, would be English. It means that we're going to try like to convey the message, the intention of the reader, and also we are going to take into the consideration the culture. Okay, the context in which these texts are developed, are written, and also the context or the culture that is our target audience. Okay, we have to take into consideration both, taking into consideration too the other definitions that we have. It's important to take into consideration the, for example, the source text that is in the next slide, please. And well, here we have like two basic concepts that we are going to be using in this time. The first one says, the language to be translated is called the source language. It means that the original language or the original text, in this case, will be Spanish, okay? And the other language, like the target language, is the one that we are going to use for Finnish or to render our transcript or our text. Okay, so first we have the source language or the source text. Also, it could be called the original text. And also we have the target language or the target text. And well, basically what I mentioned before is if we are translating something, we have to take into consideration the meaning, what the authors want to say with this text. And also we have to keep the style and the tone of this text, okay? It's important to take into account that translation has to do with the written part, okay? And yeah. Interpretation, we're going to see later, like what is this about. Then in the other one,
but something that I would like to add right here is that for both translation and interpretation, we are going to use the same these two factors, the source language and the target language. Yeah, those are really important.
Can I ask you guys a question? Because
of course,
I there's something that is curious to me is no matter what the source language or the target language is, in both I should consider the culture. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yes. Something very important, like to have in mind, is that we need to know, like deeply, the source culture and also the target culture.
Okay.
You cannot like start writing in English, let's say, without having like in mind this cultural awareness about this language, because there are some like background information that can help us to choose the best words, to choose the best expressions. There are also, for example, some idiomatic expressions that we need to know, because if not, we are not going like to transmit or to convey that message accurately. So it's important to take into consideration basic like three things: the meaning of the text, like the objective of the authors, and the culture. And also it is important also to have really written skills, because if we cannot like produce this text accurately, we are not going to transmit and be clear with the message that we are trying to translate. Okay. Do you have any question?
No, I got it. I think that's very important to consider the culture of.
Yeah, as you said, also translation and interpretation not only deals with linguistic skills, but also with cultural things and with paralinguistic skills that we are going to see later.
Okay. All right. Very good. Interesting. Interesting. Next slide.
Yes. Please. So here we have like some important characteristics about translation. Okay. If you want to be a really good translation, it's important, as I said before, to have like a good knowledge in both languages, not only in terms of culture, but also in terms of linguistic expression and let's say grammatical structures. For example, you need to know how to say correctly each sentence, each message, and you have to have that information really clear, not only in the source language, but also in the target language. Then we have another important characteristic. There is high linguistic sensitivity. Okay, and here we talk about what I mentioned before, the writer's intention. Okay, it is important like to keep the meaning, to keep what the author wants to say to the readers. Obviously, when you transfer from one language to another, the audience is going to be different. Okay, you're not going to have like the same readers because they are from different languages. But it is important to keep, like to maintain the original intention. And finally, we have that translation. It's like transfer original thoughts and opinions as clear as possible. We cannot like start adding new information or things that the author don't want to add. We have just to keep the original one as clear as possible and as accurate as possible. We can now talk about what is in the next slide that talks a little bit about the objective, okay, the objective of translation. And well, gonna explain a little bit before seeing the slide, but well, here we talk basically about what I mentioned before. There is the culture, okay, and basically the main objective of translation is to transfer the intended message and the original tone. Taking into consideration the regional and cultural differences between the target and the source language. We have to know both of them, okay? For example, we're going to find some expressions. Let's say that in example, we can say, ay, como así, something like that. We have to know how to say that in English, like with the same meaning, okay, like with the same tone, with the same style, like trying to transmit the same feeling. And we can move to the other one, please.
Okay, can I ask you a question really quickly?
Of course, tell me.
I you know, the few translations that I have done or interpretations, what you just said, for example, if somebody says ay, como así, it's happened to me because I was translating or interpreting simultaneously for German people, and I didn't know some of the things that they use in their language, which are, you know, very colloquial for them. I had no idea about that. So sometimes I would say things that they would say in the presentation, so I would interpret them for them, but I was thinking about the American culture and not the German. So, you know, we had a you know, kind of like differences in understanding each other. But my question is, how difficult is it, you know, whether you're doing it spoken or written, to think about that high linguistic sensitivity to transmit what the intention is? Do you guys consider that to be really difficult?
Okay, in the case of interpreting is more difficult because it is happening in real time, and we have to take into consideration something that is really, really important when we are doing translation and interpretation, and is the equivalence, because we don't talk about if the translation is good, is right, is perfect, or the interpretation is good, is right, is perfect. We talk about equivalence. We talk about if if that translation of or that interpretation is equivalent, if the meaning that we want to that the speaker, the source language want to express, is accurate to the expression.
Okay. So, yeah. All right, I got it. Thank you.
Well, I would say that Nicholas is like really organized with what he is saying. Sorry, because in interpretation you cannot like take a look at the dictionary and look for the word or look for the expression. No, you have to do it in real time, like simultaneously. But on the contrary, in translation, you have like the chance to look or to investigate, so you can like try to get the idea of what you want to say in the other language and say it as accurate as possible. But it is a little bit difficult because, for example, some idiomatic expressions and some things that are related like with emotions are not found in internet. So in this case, we have to have like a more, let's say, knowledge about the culture, could be like by immersion or by asking someone who maybe knows that the other language.
Okay, yeah, very interesting. Yeah, those are things that I don't know much because, you know, I'm not a, let's say, an official translator, and I really haven't studied translation, but yeah, it's interesting to know all those things.
Yeah, that's really important because the words and the terms evolve, right?
Yeah.
For example, right now, we're using some words in English, but maybe 15 or 50 years later, we're going to use another ones. Yeah. For example, we have the term selfie or the term app or emoji. Those words were not part of our vocabulary. So a translator like have to be a really, how can I say that? You have to be like
in, yeah, like he needs to know in the moment, like he needs to be like advanced
or like proficient,
like yeah, proficient. And something so curious that Nicole mentioned, that he really needs to know like that the language evolved. And I remember something particular that I realized on the internet, and it was that as the language evolved all the time, daily at least three to six words are created, and other 3 to 6 words are under usage. So it is something so curious when you are talking about like translation and interpretation, because you have to be so attentive to all of that information.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah, wow, I didn't know those things. I had no idea about those things.
Yeah, like updated.
Yeah,
that was the word that I was looking for. Our knowledge, our vocabulary has to be updated. Okay, we have to know what is happening right now and the words that we are using. Okay, this slide talks about what I mentioned before, okay, the regional and cultural differences that we have to take into consideration, not only in the first language, but also in our target language, okay?
Okay.
So we can move to the other one, please. And here we have like some different types of translation. The ones that you see here are like few, because there are many other types.
There's too much.
Talk a little bit about this because we're running out of time. Okay. So the first one is technical translation, and this is very common because it is used, for example, with user manuals. For example, when you buy something and they like translate the instructions in different languages, this one type. And then we have legal translation. And this, as its name says, has to do with all the legal part, for example, birth certificates, for example, passport translation, and all that, all the legal things that maybe some people need in order to travel to another country or to do something legal stuff. Also, we have book translation, and here we can talk about all the literary part of the languages, okay? So it is basically to translate the books, for example, many important books from English into Spanish or vice versa. Then we have multimedia translation, and this one is, let's say, very common in YouTube, for example. There are many translators that just like write the subtitles and like try to translate and to communicate the ideas in other languages. So here we can translate videos, short reels, let's say. Here we can also like talk about some signs and images. And finally, we have one that is very important, and it's medical translation. As you know, there are many, let's say, medication or important knowledge, let's say research also in English, that we cannot find in Spanish. So sometimes there are many translations that we can find from English to Spanish or from German to English. And this is very common in the medical world. So here we can translate medical orders or the instructions of the medication, of the pills, for example.
Okay, interesting, very interesting.
Well, these are some of the different types. And, well, I don't know if you have any question.
No. You explained them very well. I don't.
Yeah, you did it very well.
Okay, so then we are going to talk a little bit about some like basic steps to do a good translation, or not a good translation, but at least an accurate translation. Okay, when we talk about translation, we try not to use the word wrong or good, because we are like talking about something like very subjective.
Yeah. So subjective.
So here we have 7 steps. Okay, I'm going to talk about them a little bit like fast, but if you have any question, please let me know.
Okay.
So first of all, you are going to have your original text, okay? Your source text in any language. In this case, could be, let's say, French. So we have our text in French. The first thing that we have to do is we are going to write this text, okay? We are going to see what are the parts, what it says, okay? And while you are writing, you are going to do the second step. That is, look for terminology, okay? For example, if you are reading the first part and you don't know any word, you have to look for that vocabulary, and it is important to keep that vocabulary like in a very organized way, because maybe you are going to need it later, okay? And if you don't know those words, well, you're going to improve your vocabulary. So read the text, then look for terminology, and the third one would be research background information. This one is very important because of the cultural awareness and all the things that we talk about later. When you know what happened, like the historical record or the historical context or of the text that you are writing, you are going to better understand what the writer wants to say. Okay, so for example, if you are translating a book, let's say Persepolis, that is written, I think, in English. I have read in English. This book talks about like many problems that happens in Iraq and in Iran. No. So here we can like understand that they were in war and all of that, and the like repercussions that this had in their world and in their thinking too. So it's important to first read the text, then look for terminology and research background information. After having understanding the text and what you want to say, what you have to write, you're going to start the translation part. Okay, that will be the fourth step. And well, here you can like look for all the words that you know, like the better expressions, because you have to take into consideration the idiomatic expressions, the, for example, the formal ways to say something, and also the audience to which it is directed. Okay. Then when you have your text, your target text, you're going to reread that, okay, in order to like to look for the mistakes, for see if the punctuation is well placed and all that. The sixth one says proofreading. And when we talk about proofreading, we talk about like be sure that our text is accurate, is well redacted, is well in terms of grammar, syntax, and all these important linguistic approaches or linguistic features that it has to have. And finally, we're going to submit our translation. It's important to talk about the time that we are going to spend doing the translation, okay? If, for example, the client say, well, I need it in 1 month, we have to take it, you have to do it in 1 month, okay? It's important not to take so much time in that part because you have an agreement. Well, do you guys have any question about this part?
For you guys, which one's the most difficult of the seven?
Of the seven?
Yeah, number four?
I think, well, the translation part is the one that takes you more time. Because of course, as this involves like cultural things, sometimes you need to really look for the accurate expression. And because this is not only related with culture, but also it depends on the audience that you are that you want to impact. So if the source audience is like for example, they are kindergarten kids from a rural area, so you have to use a vocabulary that they can understand. So sometimes it's really hard, that part when you are translated, that you have to look for accurate expressions, because the idea is to translate not only the words, but also like the meaning, like the feelings, like everything that that is in the source language.
Okay. All right, good. Very yes. Interesting.
I'm in agreement with Nicholas, and I would say that also the most difficult part would be like the second one, because you spend a lot of time trying to understand the word. For example, sometimes you cannot look for the word, like the isolated word, you have to look for the entire sentence because you're not going to understand it without the context.
Yeah.
Right? So that would be like the most difficult part. Obviously the translation part is the longest one, but I think both of them.
Okay. All right. Very good. Interesting. I like that. Go to the next one.
Okay, yes, please. So now is your turn. We're going to try to translate like some sentences. They are really easy. I know you're going to do it pretty good. And well, are you ready, guys?
Yep.
Yeah, I was born ready.
Okay,
let's do it.
All right, here we go.
So we have the first one. I'm going to read it and then you can say. It is important to have into consideration the meaning, okay? You can say it like in other order, but with the same meaning. So the first one says, right now she's reading a book in the park. Who wants to try this one?
I'll try first. Okay. Just in case Nicolas says the one I want to say. Okay. So I would say, justo en este momento, ella está en el parque y está leyendo un libro.
Okay, that's pretty good.
I mean, I can change it, right?
Yeah, of course.
And I am not affecting the meaning, right?
Yeah,
of course, you can do it.
All right.
Sí, como justo ahora esto, ella está leyendo un libro en el parque.
Okay, that's pretty good.
Are you from Santander, Nicolas?
No, I'm from Meta.
Okay, because you said a very peculiar word that's from there. Esto.
Okay.
Oh, that's interesting. basically, you can say justo ahora, en este momento.
Okay.
Well, we can use another expression to say right now, or we can say it like ella está leyendo un libro en el parque en este momento, okay? Like in the contrary. The other one is, last week we went to the beach and swam in the ocean.
Okay, you want me to go first?
If you want.
Okay. So I'll say, la semana pasada fuimos a la playa y nadamos en el océano.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one is pretty easy.
Yeah.
Same thing with the order, okay? We went to the beach and then last week. So the third one, tomorrow they are going to play soccer in the backyard.
Okay, so I would say mañana ellos van a jugar fútbol en el patio.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's a part, I want to ask you both a question.
Okay.
To keep the originality of the text, is it okay for me to say mañana van a jugar fútbol en el patio?
Mm-hmm.
Or do I have to implement ellos?
There is something here, right, is particular, and is that you have to maintain like the accuracy, the accuracy. Oh. But it not affects the order or the things that you extract from the sentence, the source language. And another thing is that there are different like skills or things that you can do to translate, because you can use like literal translation, so you can translate the same thing in Spanish, but also you can do like some adaptations.
Okay.
Yes, I would say that, for example, in Spanish, sometimes we don't like write the pronoun. Okay, so in this case, we can do it in that way. Están, digo, perdón, mañana van a jugar, okay? Because we already know who van a jugar. I guess that we know that our date.
Like the conjugation of the verb is already.
Yeah, or for example, with adaptation, let's say if we are talking in San Andres, we can say soccer, because maybe they know that word, so we can say it like,
mañana,
ellos van a jugar soccer. Yeah, we can like choose that word, like use it in English, because the audience is going to understand what we want to say. Okay,
so yeah, that's why I was hesitating when I say jugar football. I said okay, football. I'm not gonna say soccer. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. If they understand, we can use it. Okay, we as translators can like choose the vocabulary and the way we want to write it.
Okay, got it.
Well, we have another ones to practice. Let's do it a little bit fast. And the fourth one says, he is watching a Marvel movie on his computer.
Okay, I would say él está viendo una película de Marvel en su computador.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And if I were in Spain, I would have to say ordenador, right?
Yeah.
Sí, exactamente. Eso depende del contexto.
And for example, if I was in Argentina, I would not say movie. I would not say película. I would say una cinta.
Una cinta.
Yeah. Sí, eso depende mucho del contexto al que se está traduciendo. Y por eso sí, and that is like the thing that the cultural and the social stuff that not only requires linguistic, but also like those social and cultural things in the translation.
Okay, good.
Well, let's continue with the fifth one. It says, on Thursday, my mom will cook dinner for my birthday. Can you try to do this one, Nicholas?
Okay, el jueves mi mamá cocinó la cena para mi cumpleaños, let's say.
Okay, here we have the verb will cook. Are you?
Ah, cocinará.
Okay.
Sorry.
That one is good.
Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Debe ser que Nicolás ya está lleno, ya comió.
I guess.
Sorry.
Entonces, en esta podemos hacer lo mismo. Mi mamá cocinará la cena para mi cumpleaños el jueves. Oh, the one that Nicolás says. He mentioned Thursday in the first place. And the last one is pretty easy. I have a dog named Max. O podemos decir como mi perro se llama Max. Okay? Mm-hmm. We're not saying the same thing, but we are like conveying the same message.
Yeah, also we can add like some pretty short things like, for example, yo tengo un perro que se llama Max. That, like adding a preposition or those kind of things.
Okay.
Yeah. So continue. This is basically all about translation. We cannot talk about, for example, the different ways to translate, the different techniques, but well, this is basically all.
Okay.
Then we're going to continue with interpretation.
Okay, yeah. I would like to ask you if you have any idea of what is interpretation.
You know, I think about translation, and translation is for me, but I don't know if I'm correct or wrong. If I translate, it's very literal. And if I interpret, it's, you know, what I comprehend. I don't know if that's.
Okay, it has something related. It is something related.
Well, I think interpretation is more like paraphrasing, like something like the professor said.
That's a better word.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move to the next slide. Okay, so interpretation is an oral form of translation, enabling real-time communication in two languages. So we say that translation, the word translation is more common to use it for written documents, for written text. And interpretation is more for oral text, oral speeches. So we can also make that comparison. We can know that interpretation as is the something that happened in real time. You are not going to say, you are not going to tell that in the same words, but you are going to try to change the words or paraphrasing, as Nicole said, but without changing the main idea. So this terminology, this ability, it is really useful for many different situations. So we can use it, for example, in face-to-face communication. For example, I'm a foreigner from, German, and I come here to Colombia, and I want to know a lot of things about culture. I want to travel, so I hire a tourist guide. That person is going to do some interpretation, because me as a foreign person that don't speak that language needs to understand the message. And also we have like we can use it for conferences or over the phone. For example, here, if we have someone that don't speak English, we can use an interpreter that transmit the information that we are sharing in English into Spanish or into the source language needed.
Okay, can I ask you a question really quick?
Of course, you can do.
So it's incorrect if somebody says necesito un traductor, or they say I need a translator. What we should say is, I need an interpreter, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. We need an interpreter, because translator is like the whole thing. I think it is something that deals with all the techniques in terms of translation, not only the oral and the written, but all about a translation. It could be a translator, but if you need to like someone to interpret, someone to translate you in real time, you need an interpreter.
Okay.
Actually, this is one of the most common mistakes when referring to a person. This is one of them like the major misconceptions, because interpretation, spoken language, and translation, written language.
Okay, interesting. I learned something today.
Yeah. Okay, so let's move to the next slide. Okay, right here we are going to talk about two different types of interpretation. There are a lot of types of interpretation, but the most common are these that I'm going to present you today, and they are the consecutive interpretation and the simultaneous interpretation. Okay, so let's start with this first one, that is consecutive interpretation. Okay, in case the interpreter is under the instruction to interpret between chunks of the original speech immediately after the original speaker has completed a few sentences, or in most cases, a fairly long paragraph. Okay, so it is well known that when you need to know something, you are going to hear. Yeah. So the idea is with this is to make some pauses, and that depends on the speaker. On the speaker that you are going to interpret. So that is not like there is not a like a rule or like a standardized number of let's say paragraph or lines or sentences to make the pauses, but that depends on the speaker. So you really need to be super fair, because you don't know if the speaker is going to talk with a lot of with little pauses, or he is going to speak properly to, that allows you to do an interpretation very good and very accurate. So, for example, let's say I am the speaker and I have like a TV show. This is something very particular. This is really, really useful for TV shows, for courts, and then we are going to see some examples. For examples, the TV show, like Jimmy Fallon. I don't know if you.
Yeah, I know which one it is.
It is like typically the guest and the host. Okay. So the host is, let's say, like Jimmy Fallon, and he only speaks English, and he has a special guest, let's say Carol G. He doesn't speak English, so he speaks Spanish. He needs to have like an interpreter right there to transmit the information. So what happens right there is like the pause. The interpreter is going to be the bridge that where is like the keyword, like the bridge between both of them, between the source language and the target language speaker. So the interpreter needs to transmit first the information from one language to another and vice versa. That needs to be bilateral. Yeah, if I am translating Spanish and English, I have to do in both ways, like English to Spanish and Spanish to English.
Okay.
And as I said, like the pauses are really, it's like the clue to know that is consecutive and they or simultaneous, because consecutive is when the speaker make a pause, he speaks, make a pause, and you as a interpreter, you translate, you convey the message into the other language, into the source language. You have any question?
No, that's clear.
I would like to say something on that part. Okay. Because, for example, if we have like a very large text or message to be interpreted, we as interpreters. We as interpreters, we can use like a notebook or something to take notes.
Okay? Note taking, yeah.
Note taking in order not to like to get lost in the process, because maybe the speaker is going to say a lot of things and we cannot remember all those things. So we can like use those notes in order to remember what we have to say.
Okay.
Yeah, as Nicole said, it is really important, because this is some of the disadvantages that we have in the oral speech, that is, it is not like so durable on time, let's say. So you have to need a really good memory, but also you can support that memory with note taking. And you're not going to write everything because time is not enough, but you are going to take some important notes that allows you to remember and lose and change the meaning of the text. And also that I want to add right here, and is something really different from translation, from written translation, and it is that this also deals with paralinguistic features, with sociocultural features, and also linguistics features, because not only your speech or the information you are going to translate is the most important, but also like the tone, the gestures, the expressions, the, you know, the body language here is really, really important.
Okay,
so next slide. Okay, here we have like a short video of a consecutive interpretation.
Okay.
Can you tell the ladies and gentlemen what happened, please?
¿Puede decirle a las señoras y señores qué fue lo que sucedió, por favor?
Estábamos sentados afuera echándonos unos tragos, fumando, usted sabe, haciendo cosas que no deberíamos estar haciendo en realidad. Estábamos sentados allá atrás comiendo plátanos y otras bobadas.
We were sitting there, we were drinking, we were smoking, we were doing things that we weren't supposed to be doing. We were sitting back there having plantains and other stuff.
Would you please be specific? Would you tell the ladies and gentlemen what you were smoking?
Entre en detalle, por favor. Dígale a las señoras y señores qué es lo que estaba fumando.
Estábamos fumando marihuana. Yo estaba fumando con unos amigos y acababa de salir del trabajo porque salí un poquito más temprano ya que yo soy capataz.
We were smoking marijuana. I was smoking with some friends. I had gotten out of work a little early because I'm the foreman.
Can you tell the ladies and gentlemen what happened from that point forward?
Dígale, por favor, a las señoras y señores, ¿qué fue lo que sucedió a partir de ese momento?
Bueno, estábamos sentados ahí reunidos, conversando, usted sabe, simplemente pasándolo como la gente común y corriente hace todos los días.
When we were there, we were sitting, gathered together, chatting the way people do normally.
Okay, bueno, we can move to the next
marihuana, tomando mezcal.
Can you tell?
Okay, that was a clear example of a consecutive interpretation. We noticed the pauses that were between the translation, between the conversation. Yeah. So then we have simultaneous interpretation. This one is harder than the previous one because this is happening in real time. Also, but without any type of pause, any type of, you know, that you can have like a rest for thinking. No, this is immediately happening. Yeah. So, is a mode of interpreting in which the speaker makes a speech and the interpreter reformulates the speech into a language while the audience understand at the same time. This is really useful in conferences, for example, in United Nations. This has a lot of, preparation and equipment to deal with this type of interpretation, because this is really, really difficult. Something that we have to clarify here is that probably here in Colombia, this not happened because we are in Colombia, but something that could happen is that a simultaneous interpreter should not be translating or interpreting more than 30 minutes, because this is too much information, this is too much pressure and too much effort for your brain, because you are doing like the bridge between the information. But something really interesting is that you as an interpreter, you're not understanding at all the information. You are not comprehending. You just are transmitting the information at the same time. So this is really particular and really interesting.
It looks.
Do you have any questions?
Difficult. No, but I know that's difficult. That has to be very difficult.
We have in the next slide a video, an example of this.
Okay.
You have the right to remain silent. Anything that you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. Do you understand that?
Sí. Yes.
You also have the right to counsel. If you're unable to afford counsel, this court will appoint counsel to represent you. Are you able to afford an attorney?
No. No.
Do you wish me to appoint counsel to represent you?
Sí. Yes.
And toward that end, have you filled out this financial affidavit?
Sí. Yes.
Can I be satisfied that the information is true?
La respuesta aquí es correcta y veraz.
Sí.
Yeah.
You have.
Okay, yeah, that was a really good example of a simultaneous interpretation.
That looks difficult. Okay. That looks really difficult.
So much difficult. Yeah. As I said, most of the time, the interpreters don't comprehend at all the message. If you ask them ask them a question, for example, related to the topic they are talking, they are not able to answer you because they are processing too much information at the same time. So that is really complicated. Okay, so here we have the process of interpretation. We have basically three steps, three things that we develop during the process of interpretation, and it's basically understanding, the conversion, transference, and delivery. Next slide, please. So first, we have the understanding process. So we have to be able, of course, to hear well the message that we are going to interpret, that we are going to translate. Also, we have to have an intimate knowledge of the language. We really need to have the ability to change or to switch like some expressions, some things in the way that you can do if you manage, you really have the power to do that by dominating the source language and the target language. Also, you have to be acquainted with the specific culture and linguistic. As I said before, you really need to know if you are going to translate and interpret someone from America, from United States. You really need to know a little bit of the culture of United States, because you are going to also translate the idiomatic things, jokes, those kind of things that you really need to understand. Also, we really need to well versed in the subject matter, and this is important because you are going to be an interpreter for a conference about medical things. You really need to know that vocabulary. You need to know if they are going to have like a conference about lung cancer, you really need to know about lung cancer. You really need to know vocabulary related to that stuff, because sometimes you can lost with the terminology used in this case. And also, you really need to possess a wide general education. This allows you to have like the ability or the facility to understand and to adapt information into different ways. The next one. Then we have conversion and transference. This is not only translating literally the information that from the source language, but also like interpret them. As you said before, like try to give an opinion, like a paraphrase, because we really need to be able to adapt and eliminate not necessary information. So we have to be able to select the information, the important information to be translated. And also, like I said before, there are some problems right here with the proverbs, metaphors, solution, jokes, after genre, stories, speakers, speakers' mistakes, obscure and ambiguous statement, and long quotation. Those things you can take them, and you in the moment of processing all that information, you can choose if you
say them, if you translate them, or just you eliminate them if you consider that it is not really relevant. Let's for the next step, please. Slide. And finally, we have a delivery. That is the part when you are going to produce the interpretation. And here, some characteristics really important that you have to take into account is like a good voice, like tone, a good tone of voice. You have to be really a good orator. You have to be like that ability to easy to understand, that your voice is really pleasant to hear and understandable. And also something really, really important is never pause or leave a sentence unfinished. You always have to finish your ideas. You have to finish like the information that you are translating, because if you don't do that, it is going to be a mess right there.
Okay. Nicolas, I'm sorry to barge in on you like this, but we have to stop because we can't go over 1 hour. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Sorry about that. But yeah, that's the rule for this. But what I do want to say is thank both of you, because you guys gave some very important, very useful information. And I think it's information that I will personally take into account. So I want to thank both of you. I want to thank Marta Roman for being with us for a while. And you guys have any last words you want to say? I'm going to jump to, some of these while you guys say. So any last words you guys want to say before we stop?
No, I feel so really grateful for being here and so excited. It was a really unique experience. It was so fantastic.
All right. Nicole?
Yes, basically the same, Professor. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to be here and to share some concepts with you.
All right. Once again, thank you to both of you. Very good information you guys provided. And for everybody watching this at a later time, thank you all for being here. If you have any questions, you have my email. And if you have any questions for our two guests, I can provide you with their emails as well. If you have any questions regarding translation or interpretation. Until then, we will talk again next year. Thank you very much to everybody who's watching, and I hope you have a very good weekend. Until next time. One second here. Give me 1 second.
Don't worry. Your microphone is off.
Okay. No, I'm saying that I'm looking for
okay.
a button to stop the recording, and I have it right. It doesn't want to stop.
But you are the one that was recording the meet.
Yeah.
I thought it was bilingualism, Universidad del Quindio.
Yeah, basically them, but they left me as the person in charge, but I guess he did not do it. And if I don't stop it, then wait, let me go in here and say. Yeah, I can't turn off the recording. And if I end the meet, then it will continue to record. And the button is right here, but it doesn't want to stop.
I think they have to do that.
Yeah, the person who's in charge, but he's not answering. Let me call him really quickly.
Yeah, don't worry.